have a seat. Welcome everybody this morning, and I'm standing up here in bare feet, and I hope that reminds you of something we spoke of. It's not too many weeks ago, but that because Jesus is in you and Jesus is in me, everywhere we go is safe. So that means God is here with us. So glad you guys are here. I know it's a little toasty outside today, but it's nice and cool and refreshing in here. And today's a special day. Every Sunday is a special day when we gather together as a community, but today's a special day to get to introduce somebody into our family this morning. But I do want to remind us before we do that, as we gather in this space, we as a people believe that following Jesus is the best way to live. We really do. And we're seeking to live that each and every day in our lives, living and loving like Jesus on mission as we're out in the community that God's called us to. And I love how you guys do that. Our community does that so well. I was reminded of that last week when we found out there was a fire at the cages. And seven of the cages, I believe, burned. And then seven people, some of our neighbors without homes, lost their homes in a fire. And quickly, as you guys heard about that, one of you went over there to check it out and find out things. And I just loved how all the texts started flowing in terms of just gathering needed supplies like soap and toothbrushes and necessary things for those ladies. So thank you for doing that. But that's just an example of being who we are. And so as we come into this place of worship on Sunday, we are celebrating that life that we live out there. And as I spoke a number of weeks ago as well, just know that as we do what we do today, the order of things that we do is called the liturgy, the work of the people, and gives us a chance to actually take the invisible grace of God and make it visible in this space. So that's why we do this, and I love that. So before we go further, I want to introduce to you someone that we've been praying for without knowing who that person was going to be. It was a goal we had a year ago, and God has answered that prayer. And so we do have our middle school youth director, who I want to introduce to you for the very first time. And I'll say his last name so the rest of you can figure that out as you go along. But let's welcome Conrad Funk. Come on up here. So when I first met Conrad and I was hanging out with him, we kept meeting, but we were sitting down. And then when he arrived yesterday, I was like, whoa. You talk. So anyway, we are excited to have you here, Conrad. And I would like to challenge us, because you did this for Betsy and I so well. In the coming days and weeks, know that he is residing in our home for 4 weeks, which is kind of a good thing. And then Fritz and Donna's cottage behind their house, when the Sanchez's go off back to what they're called to, he's going to move in there. But one of the ways you welcomed me and I got to know you is you invited me, when I was just down here by myself, over for dinner a lot. So I got to know a lot of you over a meal at your house, and then did the same thing with Betsy Dodger. So I would encourage you to recognize that he eats a plant-based diet with us every night in my house. He's going to like go and eat some other kinds of food. So I want you to feel free to invite him over to your house so that he can hang out with you and you can get to know him, because I really believe that's the best way we get to know one another. So let the invitations flow. And I'd love to have him like, oh my gosh, I've got all these meals to get to over the next few weeks. Please do that. So Conrad, I want us to get to know you a little bit. So where do you come from? Where are you coming from as you gather here in Patterson with us?
Right before this, I was a youth intern at Community Covenant Church. For 2 years there, I led the 5th and 6th grade program, and for a year, I led their high school program. It's in Rockland, California, and I lived in Roseville pretty much all my life.
Awesome. So this is a step of faith for you to come down to Patterson. Awesome. All right, so here's like an obscure question, but you kind of heard me say it yesterday, like I'm going to ask. If you walked into 31 flavors and there were no limits to what you could concoct to eat ice cream-wise, what would that look like for you?
I would order every single time chocolate peanut butter, because Baskin Robbins has real peanut butter and their chocolate peanut butter, and to me, there's no better combination.
Would you put anything on it, or are you a purist?
I'm a purist. Chocolate and peanut butter is the only combination I need.
I'm just a purist. All right, well, people here know that Betsy and I are athletic, and I love to ride bikes and work out and all of that kind of thing, but I get the feeling you may not be into what I'm into. So, like, what's Conrad into?
The main things that I spend my free time with, I listen to a lot of music. It's a lot of classic rock. My mom always tells me that I'm trying to see every musician I can before they die, because everybody I listen to made all their best music before 1985. So, a lot of that.
So he asked me, when he was planning on coming down here, he asked me, so Peter, do you have like a turntable? And I'm like, wow. I mean, I've got a digital, right? And but it turns out, you like to play mine.
Yeah, I've got about 150 records. I was an avid shopper at my record store. Yeah.
So when I sold all my records to a used record place, you bought them.
I bought them all. Besides that, I like to play a lot of video games as well. So
what's your favorite video game?
It's a really old one, because like music, I like old games. So my favorite game came out in 2001, and it's called Super Smash Bros. Melee. So
Super Smash Bros.
Yeah. All the kids know it. So
you guys know Super Smash Bros.
Yeah.
All right. Awesome. Well, Conrad, we want to welcome you, and our church put together a gift for you. So maybe if you want to present that gift to you. Well, welcome to the pastor. Bringing Conrad to us, we thank you for his life and what it's been up to this point, and we thank you ahead of time for what you're going to do in his life and through his life. Lord, we pray for all of the Muslim students in this community. There are a lot of them, Lord. This is for them. This is a gift from you for them, and so we pray that you would use Conrad in mighty ways and help us to surround him with the support he needs to do ministry here, and we thank you ahead of time for all the kids that are going to come to know Jesus because of his calling. So just watch over, guard, and protect, and provide for him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah. All right, so Mindy's got a few announcements for us before we continue. So Mindy, what you got?
Okay. Well, first of all, welcome to the gallery. And it is a blessed day that Conrad is now in our family. So we're very happy that you're here. Just a few announcements. Next Sunday, there's going to be a meeting, a very important meeting for all the volunteers that are going to be doing the Fund for Kids at the Foster's Home. It is from 4 to 6:30. So please try to make that so that you can gather there first to get together and talk about what's going to be happening that coming week. Zumba, don't forget, is here on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 8 to 9 in the family room. And then if you are wanting to get information about belonging to this church and about the church in general. Pastor's going to have a belonging week on August 11th from 1 to 4. So if you need more information on that, just see Pastor Peter. And then don't forget, after the service, we're going to meet in the family room and have a taco bar right here today. And so thank you to Heather and Ed for that. So,
keto friend.
Let's go.
Awesome. All right, if you want to stand or sit, whatever works for you as we worship. This morning is shaped for our kids.
I taught you a song last week that goes along with friendship. It's one of our TGIF songs. We'll actually do it at our kids' camp too. So I can have Sammy and Lainey come up here and kind of help us with the motions. In the TGIF, as adults, you know the song. We're teaching to you very slowly. And we're all kids at heart, so even in your seat, if you're seated, or if you're standing, we're going to do these motions because it's fun. So, ladies, you can get right there in the middle. So, we're singing the song Lean on Me, two parts of that more fuller song that Conrad probably has on vinyl somewhere. So let me walk you through it. So, the words go like this: Lean on Me. So, you're going to cross your arms and lean on the person. When you're not strong, make some muscles. I'll be your friend. Take the hands next to you and raise them up. I'll be your friend. Then because we don't know what to do with the next part, I'll be your friend. I'll help you too. We're just going to do it. Carry on. Wax on, wax off. Right. And then I'm going to sing the word four, but you're going to put a hand up and push back and say five. So let's try that. Four.
Five.
And we can do louder than that. Four.
Five.
It won't be long till I'm gonna need somebody to lean on. Now, when we do the verses, it's a little more complicated. It was fun last week watching us try to navigate through this. But on the verses, we are gonna roll our hands. We're gonna go this way first, and we'll clap. So we're gonna roll our hands and do this way. So when we're singing the words, so just call on me, brother. When you need a hand, we're just going to keep this one. So hopefully up front, we can navigate. Ooh. Thank God. Kids camp coming up. Week after next,
Many of you have different schedules and everything and have wanted to get involved in some way that Jeff's able to commit to like a greater role, but we just need people to hang out and be there with kids. So I'm just going to pass this around. If any of you are interested, just sign up on here. And if you're visiting with us and you want to get involved, give me your phone number so I can contact you. But you can come one day and just hang out and serve. You don't have to come for the whole week. We love having people hang out so on any given day. All right, so we'll start it over here and it'll work its way down. All right, so if you haven't been with us, we have this box here, and it's called a mystery box. And Christine made this for us. Is Christine in here? Yes, we did. Isn't this an awesome box? I asked her to make a box, and I was like, she's asking me, will it look like this, and look like this, and she's really concerned. This isn't her mystery box. All right, so Kristen is going to try to guess what's in the box today, but I need to show you what's in the box. So, Kristen, can you, like, look away? And I'm going to show all of you guys what's in the box because she's going to ask you questions and try to figure out what's in it. So let me show you what's in the box. I'll show everybody out there. Let me see what it is. Now, Kristen is going to try to guess what's in the box, and she gets to ask five questions. And if you want to answer her question, the answer is either going to be yes or no. So you can raise your hand, and she'll call on you. So, Kristen, let's try for it.
Okay. First question, is it something I can smell?
You raise your hand, who wants to answer the question?
No.
Can't eat it.
Is it something I can play with? No.
No, can't.
preschoolish, toddlerish, you can go with the parent. And if any parent needs to go along on that journey, you can go back there. And you get them back in the family room after we're done. So today's story about Jonathan and David, I think it's just an amazing, amazing story of friendship, and it's one of those friendships that stands out to me because it stood the test of time. It was a friendship that knew really no boundaries. These two men were committed to one another, and I think in our world today, as we navigate through friendships and relationships with other people, for many of us, friendships kind of come and go. Sometimes, depending on the circumstances of our lives, friends, we become distant from them. Sometimes we can be going through a rough time and our friends don't know how to handle it, and so they distance themselves from us. Many of you may have experienced that. Sometimes maybe you made a mistake in the relationship or whatever, and you guys kind of like, I'm kind of not happy with you, and we move on. And we see that in our culture in terms of even marriage relationships, how quickly, when it gets hard and it gets tough and somebody makes a mistake, we just part. But what really stands out to me in this relationship is just this idea of loyalty and what loyalty looks like. And Jonathan and David had a very deep friendship. And back then, when friendships were made by thinking through this idea of a covenant relationship. And what that meant was the relationship, no matter what happened in your life, is going to be unwavering. It was an unconditional, if you want to call it that way, commitment to one another till death. So literally, if we wanted to become friends, and we made a covenant relationship with one another, that means no matter what happens circumstantially around, you and I are friends to the end. I remember when I was younger, there was a thing going around, and do not do this, and AIDS kind of changed this, but I remember sometimes we would do a thing and with friends, we'd be blood brothers. You know, one of us would hurt our hands playing and be like, oh, dude, we're buddies, man. You grind that into our hands and see blood brothers. And in a way, it was that kind of thing. If you had a covenant relationship with someone back in the day, thousands of years ago, it's what our marriage commitment comes from. It literally meant that ceremonially, you were no longer going to live with yourself. You were going to die to yourself so that you could be in this relationship with the other person. And your whole goal in life was that the other person would thrive. Whenever they needed you, you would be there. No matter what happened, you would be there till death. And that's where we get the phrase in the marriage ceremony, till death do us part. It comes from this idea of covenant relationship. So I was kind of thinking and reflecting on this in my own life in terms of what does that look like for us? What does it look like to have an unwavering relationship, an unconditional relationship, a love that you have that no matter what happens in your life, you can keep together. And the first thing that comes to mind is this idea of belief. Believing in the other person. Do you have or are you a friend in someone else's life where you believe in them so much no matter what happens, your belief in who they are will not change? Do you have a friend in your life who's so loyal to you, committed to you, that unwaveringly their belief in you will not change even if you have a terrible moment? And I think in many ways, sometimes that's where friendships part. Some of you may have had people you thought were your friends and they betrayed you, which really goes against that idea that I have a friend who believes. They know me so well that no matter what they hear, no matter what they see, they know the depth of who I am enough that they believe in me. How well do we know each other? How well do we look for the best in other people that we would continue to believe in them no matter what we hear, even what we might see? Because guess what? We all have bad moments, don't we? We all do. But we need to have friendships where people believe in us. Another word that comes to mind is having unwavering trust. Do you have a friend, or are you a friend to someone that you trust completely? Which means you can share anything with them and it stays there. It doesn't go out on Snapchat. It doesn't go out on Twitter. It doesn't go out on Facebook. It stays right there. They don't talk to other people about what we share. Are you that kind of a friend? And believe it or not, we need to have friends that we can trust.
We need to have friends that we trust enough that if we ask them, they would tell us the truth. You know, we could ask them an honest question. Can you be honest with me? Am I this way? Are you seeing this in me? And the trust would be such that they could speak truth into our life and we would receive it. And we would know that when they say that truth to us, it's not a put down, it's not a saying, I don't want to be your friend because you're this way. We trust each other so much, we can be that vulnerable and that transparent. Do we have a friend that is unwaveringly present? Are we unwaveringly present in the life of another person? Jonathan, in this story with David, he would find out things. He was in David's life so much. When David was out there in fear that his father was going to come take him out because he was going to be the next king, Jonathan took huge risks to be present. And part of having a loyal friend is that you're a part of their life. You're around them. You're present, especially in times of trouble. I love this proverb. It says, a friend loves at all times. A brother is born, or sister, for a time of adversity, which means when the stuff hits the fan, are you there? I had a friend one time say, do you have a 3 o'clock in the morning friend? Someone in the middle of the night that you could call and they would drop everything. They'd get out of bed and they'd come to you. Do you have a friend that if they were at work and you were having a terrible moment, they would even go to their boss and go, look, I've got a friend whose life is in crisis right now. He or she needs me. I've got to take some time off. And you would leave. You'd leave what you're doing to be present. That's loyalty. That's a loyal friend. And then lastly is this unwavering love. It said that Jonathan and David, they loved one. They were one in spirit. There was this deep love there. And Jonathan's having to navigate through, I got to honor my dad as the king, but I love David so much, I'm not going to let my father bring harm to my best friend. That's how deep that love went. He respected his father. He respected his father so much, in the end, he ended up losing his life. Because he respected his father, he loved David so much, he led David in a direction that was actually life-saving to David's life. That's a love that just, man, it goes beyond everything. And I think we need to have friends that we can honestly say to one another, I love you. Now, that phrase, I love you, even in marriage relationships or other relationships, we assume it a lot. But how often do we tell our best friends, not in a creepy way, but we have such a good relationship, I love you. And I don't think we say enough. To our friends. Do we say that to our friends? I love you. That says something. And I think that draws us closer and closer together as friends. So, a couple of questions just to reflect on. This kind of loyalty that I've described, do you have someone like that in your life right now? You can just name it. Right now, I have that person. Some of you may have had. Some of you never have one, maybe you've longed for one. All of us need to have a friend like that in our life. It's hard to go through life without a friend like that. Some of us are married and we have that kind of relationship with our spouse, but I would challenge you, even within your marriage, outside of your marriage, do you have a friend like that? Because you need to have a friend. And it actually helps you strengthen your marriage if you're in that relationship. We all need to have. Now, some of you might not have one. And my mom used to tell me this, because I'm a very relational person, you've got to figure that out. And I would say to my mom sometimes, I don't have any friends, nobody likes me. Especially middle school, that was really rough. You know what my mom would say? You probably know what she said. If you want to have a friend, be a friend. I think in some ways maybe we need to reflect and say, who in my life right now needs me? And I think if you take that step and you become a loyal friend to someone, guess what? They will become one of your loyal friends. There might be someone in your life right now that is so needy of a friend that if you became their friend, became that loyal to them, they might end up becoming that loyal friend that you always said earlier. this I know in my own life, Jesus has been the most loyal friend I've ever had. Lay down his life. That doesn't change. That does not go away. So maybe you don't have that friend right now. I want to encourage you to know that Jesus can be that friend. And if you want to know what his life looks like, just pick the Gospel of Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John. Maybe you need to read the Gospel of John, because John is referred to as the disciple that Jesus loved. He refers to himself that way. Maybe he got that. And discovered the love that Jesus has for you, the loyalty that he should have for you. And I would encourage you to do that. So that's what I had this morning. So why don't you take some time and just reflect. What did you hear the Lord saying to you this morning? What did the Holy Spirit say to you personally this morning in regards to friendship?
Yeah.
and it enables us to continue the work that God has for us, including bringing someone like Conrad on to be a part of our ministry. So I thank you so much for your generosity every week, and we're going to worship God through our giving.
All right, please pray with me. Dear Lord, we thank you. Thank you for another chance for us to meet together in your house to worship you, Lord. We experience your blessings every day. Just did is not acceptable. But when you
Yeah.